ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام.
Can you please collect those children, separate them from one another?
Okay, boy.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. وبعد, today is Friday and today's date is the 5th of Dhul Qa'dah for the year 1433rd of the Hijra, of the migration of our great beloved Prophet Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, which coincides with the 21st of September for the year 2012. Before I start the class, let me share with you these two ahadith from Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. And the first hadith I am reading from Sahih al-Bukhari, just to show you the generosity of Allah al-Kareem subhanahu wa ta'ala and something else. عن أبي واقد الليثي رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بينما هو جالس في المسجد والناس معه إذ أقبل ثلاثة نفر. أبو واقد الليثي, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, reported that while Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam was sitting in al-masjid among the people, إذ أقبل ثلاثة نفر, when three men arrived or approached, فأقبل اثنان إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم وذهب واحد. So two of them approached closely to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and one of them turned away. قال فوقف على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. So they kept walking until they stood next to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. فأما أحدهما فرأى فرجة في الحلقة فجلس فيها وأما الآخر فجلس خلفه. He said one of them found a space on the circle around Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and he sat there and the other person sat behind them. وأما الثالث فأدبر ذاهبا and the third person turned his back and left. فلما فرغ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم, when رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم finished his teachings, قال ألا أخبركم عن النفر الثلاثة, shall I inform you about those three men, أما أحدهم فآوى إلى الله فآواه الله. One of them, he came to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took him to his custody. وَأَمَّا الْآخَرُ فَاسْتَحْيَا فَاسْتَحْيَا اللَّهُ مِنْهُ and the other person, the second person who sat on the back, he said he was shy and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was shy of him, i.e. he is going to reward him best. وَأَمَّا الْآخَرُ فَأَعْرَضَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. In regard to the third person, he turned away his back and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned away from him. Amazing. The other hadith is in Sahih Muslim and reads عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم قال إن لله تبارك وتعالى ملائكة سيارة فضل إزاء أبو هريرة may Allah be pleased with him reported that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said what? There are angels for Allah تبارك وتعالى. There are patrolling angels for Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And their courtesy is يتبعون مجالس الذكر. They look for the sittings where Allah سبحانه وتعالى is remembered. فإذا وجدوا مجلسا فيه ذكر قعدوا معهم. And whenever they find a sitting where the people are remembering Allah سبحانه وتعالى, those angels, patrolling angels, they will sit with them. وحف بعضهم بعضا بأجنحتهم حتى يملأوا ما بينهم وبين السماء الدنيا. الله أكبر. And they will what? Keep coming one surrounding the other, one surrounding the other until they fill the space between the earth and the first sky, the first heaven. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that all these angels now are in our company. Then, فَإِذَا تَفَرَّقُوا عَرَجُوا. And when they are go different ways, the people who are sitting, they go to their different ways. عَرَجُوا وَصَعِدُوا إِلَى السَّمَاءِ. They go up and they what? They ascend to the what? To the sky. قال فيسألهم الله عز وجل وهو أعلم بهم من أين جئتم. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask them while he knows about them. Who knows? While he knows best about them. Where did you come from? فيقولون جئنا من عند عباد لك. We came from visiting slaves of yours. في الأرض, on earth. يسبحونك ويكبرونك ويهللونك ويحمدونك ويسألونك. They make تسبيح for you. They say الله أكبر. They say لا إله إلا الله. They say الحمد لله. And they ask you, they pray to you to give them. قال وماذا يسألوني. And what they ask me. قالوا يسألونك جنتك. They ask you for your paradise. قال وهل رأوا جنتي. Allah سبحانه وتعالى will ask the angels, have these people seen my Jannah, my paradise? قالوا لا أي رب. Say no, oh our God. قال فكيف لو رأوا جنتي. What would be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, what would be their case if they were to see my paradise? قالوا ويستجيرونك. And they seek refuge with you. قال ومما يستجيرونني. Allah says, and they seek refuge with what? They seek refuge with me from what? قالوا من نارك. They seek refuge with you from your hell. Fire. من نارك يا رب. Oh our Lord. They seek refuge with you from your hell fire. قال وهل رأوا ناري. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى will ask. Have they seen my hell fire? قالوا لا. قالوا لا. قال فكيف لأو رأوا ناري. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى says, what about if and how their case would be if they were to see my fire? قالوا ويستغفرونك. And the angels would say, and they ask you to forgive them. قال فيقول الله عز وجل قد غفرت لهم فأعطيتهم ما سألوا وأجرتهم مما استجاروا. الله أكبر. Allah at that point will say, I what? I forgave them and I gave them whatever they asked me, al-Jannah, and I am going to save them from what? From the hellfire. قال فيقولون رب. And the angel say, Ya Allah, our Lord, فيهم فلان عبد خطاء إنما مر فجلس معهم. Said, يا الله. But among them, there is a slave of yours. Who is what? Who is an oft sinner. An oft sinner. And he was passing. So when he found them, he just sat with them. قال فيقول أي فيقول الله عز وجل ولهم وله غفرت هم القوم لا يشقى بهم جليسهم. Said, well, and to him, and to him I forgive. And him I forgive. He said, why? Because these are the people that that it is my promise that the one who sits with them will never suffer. How many people are missing now on this reward? And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you all of the reward. This is just by sitting. And the first hadith, just by turning your back. Now back to our subject. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, some of our brothers and sisters this year are going to Hajj. And for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our Hajj, we have to have certain requirements quickly, like any deeds. First, the intention has to be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we spoke about that in details. Second, you have to make the Hajj according to the what? To the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Third, when you are there, you have to what? To be free of sin. Not going there to sin. You are going there to shed off your sin and to come back free of sins as the day you were born. And a condition that of extreme importance, that the money that you use to make Hajj must be pure halal, every single grain of it. Otherwise, don't trouble yourself. Don't trouble yourself. Now, inshallah Rabbil Alameen, I will make this material available for anyone who wants to make Hajj. And it says, first point, the Muslim who wishes to make Hajj without bringing an animal to slaughter from his, her homeland as hadi, as sacrifice, must make the intention for Hajj al-Tamattu', which means that he or she should have the intention to first make Umrah and then come out of his or her ihram state until the 8th day of the Hijjah, then he or she enters the state of Ihram again and makes Hajj. What does that mean? We have three types of Hajj. We have Hajj al-Tamattu', Hajj al-Qiran, and Hajj al-Ifrad. Hajj al-Ifrad, the intention is to make Hajj only, no Umrah. Hajj al-Qiran is to make Hajj and Umrah without separation. That means after you finish the Umrah, you will stay in the state of Ihram until you perform Hajj. You will throw the first Jamarat al-Aqabat al-Kubra on the 10th. Then you start coming out of your state of Ihram. And the third, which is Hajj al-Tamattu'. Hajj al-Tamattu', as we said, that it is a must upon the Muslim who does not bring the sacrificial animal with him from home, his homeland, or before he enters the miqat, the borders that nobody is allowed to cross without being in the state of ihram, then he or she must have the intention to perform what? Hajj al-Tamattu'. What is Hajj al-Tamattu'? Hajj al-Tamattu', that means you have the intention to make Umrah first, and then you make Hajj. After you make Umrah, you will what? come out of the state of ihram, and everything that was made unlawful to you by entering the state of ihram goes back to being normal, lawful, and you stay a citizen, no restrictions whatsoever, until what? The Hajj day, until the day of Hajj, which is the 8th day of the Hijjah. Yeah? The 8th day of the Hijjah. And once the 8th day of the Hijjah, you enter the state of Ihram again to what? To start performing the Hajj. Anyone doesn't know what is Hajj al-Ihram? Hajj, sorry, Hajj al-Tamattu. Hajj al-Tamattu. Anybody? It's okay. Okay? Now, second, it is recommended for the one who wishes to make Hajj to bathe before entering the state of Ihram. It is recommended, that means not obligatory, but it is highly, highly encouraged. That means if you do not do it, you are not blameworthy, you are not sinning. It is recommended that, it is recommended for the one who wishes to make Hajj to bathe, take a shower, clean himself or herself well before entering the state of Ihram. It is recommended that for man only, not the woman, to put on, to wear some perfume before entering the state of Ihram. After entering the state of Ihram, using the perfume in any way, shape or form is forbidden, is unallowed, it is haram. Now, it is a sin to do it what? Intentionally. Now, third, I think they are not liking the class. Okay. Third, then the man, we are talking about the man, the male, not the female, then the man must wear the clothing of Ihram, which is Izar, which is the towel, that you wear around what? Your waist. A lower garment, a piece of fabric in the shape of a towel, and rida, an upper garment, a piece of fabric in the shape of a towel. So when you go to Hajj, for the man and the man only, you have to take off your tailored clothes. Any clothing that you are wearing now, they are called tailored. There is no such thing called stitched. Tailored, that means made to the shape of your body or part of your body. The man is not allowed to wear those tailored clothings when making Hajj. Okay? Or Umrah. So what does he wear? He will get a piece of fabric that makes sure it is not see-through. And what, you wear it around your waist, and another piece, and you wear it on the top of your body, not just on your shoulders, and the belly is exposed and the back is exposed. This is not allowed, especially when you are making the salah. Okay? And this is for the man only, and it doesn't have to be in a certain color. Rasulullah, although he made it, and most of the Muslims, they made it in what? On while they were wearing white clothes. But Rasulullah sometimes he wore green. It is not common nowadays, but anything will do, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. And as you noticed, I said what? It is not tailored. But what about if there are stitches around here and stitches around here? That is fine, there is no problem. The word makhit, someone invented this, as we said so many times. It is not from the words of what? Al-Quran al-Kareem, nor the words of what of the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And unfortunately, the word makhiyat has been translated to be what? Stitched or sewn. This is incorrect. Stitch makhiyat, it means what? It is what? In the shape of what? My garment, his garment, your sirwal, your shirt, and so on and so forth. Okay? Furthermore, the man must not wear any garment that is sewn, like a shirt and pants, nor should he wear underwear or a dishdasha, a robe, or an abaya, which is a cape, etc. Moreover, he must wear ni'al, which is, pay attention, because the word ni'al in the Arabic language, it is any shoes that does not reach the ankles. See the ball? The ball above your foot, it is called what? It is called an ankle. An ankle. The back is a heel. This ball is called what? An ankle. So any shoes that does not reach the ankle is called what? Ni'al. So you do not have to wear flip-flops. Flip-flops. Any shoes. Okay? That is called ni'al. Which is any slippers or shoes which does not reach up to the ankles. Then he, the man, must also leave his head bare. This is a bare head. Nothing on his head. No hat, no turban, no any covering on the head. Not like an umbrella, not like a ceiling, not like the roof of a bus. Because when you go there, if it's your first time, you are going to see this, what? Unroofed buses. We have nothing to do with it. This is for some people. They have a religion called Shi'ism. We have nothing to do with that. Okay? So, to have a shirt, that is fine. But anything you wear on your head, as a man, you have to take it off. Regardless of the shape or the way it is what it is worn on the head. Okay? Without wearing any head covering, not a hat or a head wrap or a turban. Any questions so far about how you supposed to dress or you supposed not to dress while in the state of ihram for the man? Any questions? Yes, Hayden.
When you go in the plane or move around, you know, although you take it, although you put the upper piece really well, you still, you know, may get exposed every now and then. Is that okay?
As long as you keep what? Fixing it.
Okay.
But not, as long as you what? Keep fixing it. Because this was, because the rida and the izar, ya akhwa, was the most common, garment or garments that was worn by what? By Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba al-Kiram. Most of what they used to dress in is what? Is this two garments. Then we have what we call it the qamis. That's the qamis. Even if you open the actual dictionary, you're going to find the word qamis. Qamis is not the shirt that we wear. And third, which was the rida. And the shirwal, not the pants, the shirwal, that means big, huge, wide, pants. So, and sometimes they will what? They will come loose and they used to fix it and correct themselves. Yes, any other question? No question? Okay. Next, fourth. The woman must not. That means not allowed. It is not sunnah. It is haram. The woman must not remove anything of her normal Islamic garments or her shoes. That means she can dress in any garment as long as she is what observing the Islamic dress code of the Muslim woman in public, i.e. what they call it people now, the hijab, okay, or the jilbab, okay. So she can wear any shoes, she can wear any, it's like she knows she dresses what normally, but she must, that means it is unlawful to keep, she must remove the niqab or the burqa', yeah, the niqab or the burqa', which is translated as face veil, okay. The burqa' is where the eyes are what are seen, and the niqab, which is basically nothing is what is shown, okay. Remove the niqab or the burqa', which is the face veil, from her face. Although she can veil her face if she wishes, this is the exact word of Aisha radiallahu anha, if she wishes, by headscarf which she puts on her head and allows to hang down over her face freely. And she must remove the gloves which are worn on the what? Palms of the hands. Okay? So the woman must not wear a niqab, must not wear a burqa', must not wear an ithaam. And these are the exact words in the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha. But the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and the wives of As-Sahaba al-Kiram, most of them in their daily lives, they used to cover what? Most of them, the great majority, they used to cover everything, including what? The face. So during the Hajj, what was the prohibition? The prohibition is to wear the covering of the face, that is called niqab, that is called burqa', that is called the lithaam. But what they used to do if they want to keep covering, literally, they used to take a piece of fabric, okay? And they put it on the head, and I'm sure that I demonstrated this so many times over the years. They will take it, and they put it on the head, and let it fall what? Freely. When they are in public, that means they are exposed to the mirror, they will let it what? Go down. If they are not in front of the mirror, they would what? Roll it over. And again, you are going to go to Hajj, and you are going to see some funny things. Example. We're going to see women wearing a Mexican hat, yeah, and what? And they are wearing what? A piece of fabric over it, or a baseball cap. And again, they are these things. And if you ask them, they say because the fabric must not touch our face. It's prohibited for the fabric to touch our face. So they came with this what? Bid'ah, this invention, the Mexican hat or the cap. So they will what? They will let the fabric fall freely, but what? Going this way. Yeah? Or going from all the ways. This is not the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is not how the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the wives of As-Sahaba used to do, all that he used to do, they will take a fabric, or sometimes even the same garment they are wearing, and they did it what? For freely. But to take a niqab and wear it like this, or this way, that is tailored for the face, this is not allowed. Same thing with what? With the gloves. Anybody doesn't know what the gloves? Huh? So what they used to do at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, literally, they used to do, they needed to keep their hands covered. See what I'm doing now? See? Am I on camera? Okay. See? So I make it long, so it would be like this. Or I can even stand and still my hands like this. Huh? Now you see them, now you don't. Now you see them, now you don't. Okay? But you are not allowed to wear one gloves. But this is how they used to do at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Any question regarding the dress code in the state of Ihram of the woman that is making Hajj. Yes, please.
So, Sheikh, is it okay for a woman to have a dress specially made?
Yes. To make it long?
Yes.
But it's going to be terrible. She is going to have hard time. Just you need to teach her, like in the Salah, and this is for everybody to learn. Just all you need is just to know some physics. If you go down, everything will be covered, correct? Yeah? You don't have to show anything. Just you know how to walk, to walk. So the same thing, all she needs is just to lower her shoulders a little, and she will be what? Very normal. But if they are long, trust me, it's going to be a headache. Yeah. Any other question? Okay. Fifth. It's time for adhan. Is it time for adhan? Okay, let's stop here, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. And tomorrow, inshallah, we'll pick up from where we left. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. جزاكم الله خير for coming and جزاكم الله خير for